In this session of the course 1, that is food fundamentals, we will be taking the block of nutrition. We have with us Ms. Para Shinoy. She is working in the Shahid Rajguru College. She is nutritionist from the MS Baroda University. She will be discussing all the aspects about the fundamentals, about the nutrition, that is advantages, what are the energy value of foods, and what are the toxins are present. Nowadays, we are listening, and even you must be reading in the paper about the pesticides in some of the cola drinks. So those aspects are becoming important. I will request Ms. Para to cover about the nutrition aspects about this course.
Today we are taking up block 3, nutrition. In this we have 4 units: nutritional aspects, food for growth and repair, loss of food value in fresh produce and processed products, and anti-nutritional factors, food contaminants and toxic elements. Let us start with first unit, that is nutritional aspects. Food. We need food for growth, development and to lead a healthy lifestyle. Anything which can be eaten, digested, absorbed, metabolized and helps us in growth and development is food. So medicines cannot be considered as food. How food helps in growth? Because it provides us nutrients. A nutrient is any chemical substance that can be used by an organism to sustain its metabolic activity. For example, carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins and minerals, these are all nutrients. Now, what do nutrients do? They improve our nutritional status. Nutritional status can be defined as the state of health of an individual as influenced by the nutrients ingested. A well-balanced diet leads to a good nutritional status, and we can see it in when a person is having good eyesight, pink cheeks, good hard working capability. For example, you can see in this picture. What happens when nutritional status is not good? This leads to malnutrition. Now, malnutrition includes both the extremes, obesity and undernutrition. Today our world and India is facing both the problems of malnutrition. In India, about 53% of all the children are suffering from chronic undernutrition in form of kwashiorkor and marasmus. You can see this is a picture of a marasmic child. At the same time, we are also facing the problem of obesity. Again, a study has shown that 1 in every 3 men in India in the middle and elite segments and 1 in 2 women were obese. Not only this, obesity also comes along with other problems like diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular problems and many other related disorders. Now we come to energy. Why do we need energy? Energy is required for 3 functions of our body: basal metabolism, physical activity and dietary thermogenesis. Let us first take basal metabolism. This is the energy metabolism of a subject at complete physical and mental rest, having normal body temperature and post-absorptive state. So mental and physical rest doesn't mean that the person should be sleeping, because during sleeping basal metabolic rate decreases, and post-absorptive state is very essential, because when we eat food our body starts spending energy on it. So the person should not have eaten anything at least 12 hours before the experiment is done. We need basal metabolism for various vital functions of our body, for example kidney functioning, heartbeat, breathing, etc. Basal metabolic rate can be measured as the amount of calories expended hourly in relation to the surface area of body. It is measured in kilocalorie per meter square per hour, and there are various factors which influence BMR, like body surface area. Higher body surface area means a taller person will have higher BMR. Similarly, as age increases, BMR decreases. Temperature has an effect. For example, in winters, when we need to conserve energy, when we need to, our body wants to be heated up, BMR will increase so that we get heat. In summers, BMR will decrease. Then in conditions of fever, BMR will increase and we will start losing weight. In conditions of stress, as you may have seen, like people who are tensed and who are under stress, they start losing weight. Why? Because their BMR is high. Then coming to physical activity. Physical activity is of 3 kinds: light, like teaching, studying, like I am doing a light activity. Then moderate, like agricultural work, basket weaving, etc. And heavy workers are rickshaw pullers, miners, hill climbers. We have to take energy, consume energy according to our needs. Suppose I am a light worker, and if I start taking energy requirements which are for heavy worker, then obviously I'll gain weight. Then third aspect of energy is dietary thermogenesis. This is the amount of energy utilized by our body to digest, absorb, transport and store the nutrients. Like, nutrients do provide us energy and nutrients, but we also have to spend some energy. This energy which is spent on digesting nutrients is called dietary thermogenesis or specific dynamic action or even thermic effect of food. So now we can say that total energy requirement of our body is equal to total energy intake, which should be equal to BMR plus physical activity plus dietary thermogenesis. Only then the nutritional status will be good. Coming to energy value of foods, we have in our foods proteins, carbohydrates and fats, which provide us energy. They are the direct sources of energy. And we also have minerals and vitamins, which do not provide us direct energy, but they help to liberate energy from food. By using an instrument called bomb calorimeter, it has been found that 1 gram of carbohydrates give us 4.1 kilocalories, whereas 1 gram of protein give us 5.65 kilocalories. After this, we come to different food groups. Food can be divided into groups like cereals and millets, legumes and pulses, fats and oils, vegetables. They all provide us most of the nutrients, but they are also deficient in some of the nutrients. For example, cereals and millets, they give us protein, but they lack very essential amino acid lysine. So we have to take some other food which should give lysine. Similarly, nuts and oil seeds, they are rich in proteins and B vitamins, but they are not so rich in fat soluble vitamins. Fruits and vegetables, they give us vitamins and minerals, but they are not so rich in essential fatty acids. Milk, eggs, meat, fish, poultry, they are all animal foods and they give us almost all the nutrients in very good amounts. So they can be considered as complete food. Then we have some other foods like sugar, jaggery, which do not provide us minerals and vitamins, but are good source of energy. Now we have seen all the food groups and also learnt about energy, we come to food pyramid. Food pyramid gives us a guideline and outline of how to choose foods, which foods to choose and in what proportions. As we see, when we look at the base of the food pyramid, first thing comes is daily exercise and weight control. Now daily exercise is very important. That means before looking for food and choosing foods, we should first start exercising. Then the pyramid shows whole grain foods and olive oil, etc. So oils are also very important part of our body. As we go up the pyramid, last thing comes red meat and butter. So we should take them, but not in higher amounts. Most of us can also take multiple vitamin tablets, but it should not be taken every day. And you should look for food-based approach. Now let us understand digestion of food first. Digestion of food starts in mouth, where salivary glands, they release a juice called in saliva, which has various enzymes. Now carbohydrates, which are made up of starch, sugars, they are acted upon by salivary amylase and converted to maltose and dextrins, which are smaller units of carbohydrates. And fats are also hydrolyzed to some extent and some melting occurs. But proteins are not digested in mouth. Then all this mixture of food through esophagus, which is the food pipe, it goes to stomach, where carbohydrates are not digested anymore. For some time, salivary amylase remains active, but then it gets deactivated because of the presence of HCl. Fats are also digested by gastric lipase and proteins are converted to shorter units, that is polypeptides, by the action of pepsin and HCl. Then again, this mixture of food, digested food, which is called as chyme, C-H-Y-M-E, chyme, this goes to small intestine, where carbohydrates are acted upon by amylase, which comes from pancreas, and converted to disaccharides, maltose, lactose, sucrose, and then by enzymes maltase, lactase and sucrase, they are ultimately converted to glucose, fructose and galactose, which are monosaccharides and which are absorbed by diffusion. Fats are first emulsified by bile, which comes from gallbladder, and then they are converted into mono and diglycerides and fatty acids by the action of enzyme lipase, which comes from pancreas. Then these final products are packaged with lipoprotein, phospholipid and cholesterol into spherical balls known as chylomicrons, which are then absorbed in the lymphatic system and then go to blood. Lastly, polypeptides, they are again acted upon by pancreatic enzymes, trypsin, chemotrypsin, proaminopeptidases, and converted to amino acids, which are the block units, which are the smallest units in a protein chain, and then they are absorbed by simple diffusion. So now we have seen food groups, understood digestion. Now we come to recommended dietary allowances. RDAs or recommended dietary allowances are the measures of nutritional need in terms of specific amount of nutrients a person should receive every day. That means if I'm asked to take say 2060 kilocalories of energy every day, I should take it every day. Similarly, RDAs have been given for all the vitamins, minerals, all the nutrients and for all age groups by FAO and WHO for world population, and for India, Indian Council of Medical Research, that is ICMR, it has given RDAs for Indian population. When we know about RDAs and about all the food groups, we should also learn something about food exchange list. A food exchange list has all the food exchanges, that is food groups, like we can see here milk, meat, pulse, cereal, vegetables, fruit, fat and sugar. Milk group means all the milk and milk products will be included in this group. In this table, we also have proteins, carbohydrates, fat and energy. For example, 8 gram of protein is provided by milk group. Similarly, 15 gram of carbohydrate is provided by cereal group. So, cereal includes wheat, rice and all the cereals. So, we can choose different foods from these groups and make a balanced diet when we know the RDAs and about these food groups. Now, when we will eat a balanced diet, our nutritional status is bound to improve. How do we measure nutritional status? There are various techniques. First is anthropometric measurement. Here we take height and weight of the individual and skin fold thickness. For example, if height is good according to age, we can say that the person has good nutritional status. Then in clinical assessment, we look for pallor in eyes. For example, if eyes are pale, we will say that the person is anemic. Similarly, if bite-out spot, a spot in eye is there, which is typical of vitamin A deficiency, we will say, okay, the person is deficient. Then in biochemical assessment, we assess parameters in laboratory. For example, we all know hemoglobin test is done, then urine test, stool test for parasitic infestation. Then in biophysical assessment, using radiology, we look for various aspects of particular disease. Like in case of rickets, we would look for swollen joints. In osteomalacia, we would look for bone fractures inside or swollen joints again. In case of vitamin A deficiency, there are certain tests which are done under this kind of assessment. The next is dietary intake, where we do 24-hour dietary recall. We see what is the diet which is being taken by an individual. By using food frequency questionnaire or by 24-hour dietary recall, we will come to know what diet a person is taking and so how is the nutrition status. Then in vital statistics, we look for parameters like mortality ratio in a population, like how many deaths have occurred because of maybe cholera or by diarrhea, or how many cases of night blindness are there in a particular age group. This will tell us about the overall nutritional status of a community. Lastly, ecological studies, which are indirect forms of assessment, nutritional assessment, where we look for various factors like education, socioeconomic factor, condition of women. These will also indirectly affect nutritional status. Coming to last topic, that is nutritional labeling. Why is nutritional labeling important? See, this is a label. Now, a label should be there on all products for which a claim has been made that it has some nutritional properties. For example, when we take health drinks, we should know what is the nutritional property of that health drink, what is the protein content, energy content. Similarly, suppose I want to take a low sodium diet, then I should find that low sodium label on the pack. So for any fortified food, for any special food, it is required. It improves consumer awareness, and food processors will also come to know what kind of product they are manufacturing, and people who require special diets, for example, in case of high cholesterol, people who have high cholesterol problem, they would like to take a food which has low cholesterol. So by looking at the nutritional label, they can choose their food accordingly. So this ends our unit 8. Now we come to next unit, food for growth and repair. Why is knowledge of nutrition important? Because every food has a different nutritional profile. We have to use all the foods properly, judiciously, as we have already seen in the first unit. And always it is good to have a food-based approach rather than going for vitamin and mineral supplementation. Let us learn something about structure of foods now. You can see here, this is the structure of a flower and a plant. All fruits develop from flower, ovules which are part of a flower, they develop into seeds and ovary develops into a flower. We can have various fruits, they come from various parts of a flower. Similarly, from a plant, we know that root give us carrot, brinjal and tomato, they come from fruits, and potato comes from stem and tuber. Then texture. This is a combination of sensations derived from the lips, tongue, walls of the mouth, teeth and even ears and hand. Texture is what we feel from with our mouth and with teeth and even ears. Like when we eat a potato chip, we will crush it between our teeth and we will also hear a particular sound from it. That sound will be associated with the freshness. If the potato chip is, say, in rainy season when it becomes soggy, it will not give that sound which comes from a fresh chip or from a fresh biscuit. There is some different kind of sound. Similarly, when we touch a fresh bread, it will press very easily, whereas a dry bread, stale bread will crack. The next aspect of food is flavor, which combines taste and smell and even heat and cold. There are various compounds like aldehydes, ketones, glycosides and sulfur compounds which are responsible for flavor of a food. For example, we get very strong flavor and smell from onion and garlic. This is because of sulfur compounds which are present in them. Color. Foods have different colors. You have seen so many colors in fruits and vegetables. They are because of natural pigments which are present in foods. For example, chlorophyll is responsible for green color, and anthocyanins are responsible for red and blue color in grapes, strawberries, etc. Then polyphenols are present in many fruits and vegetables like apples and brinjal. Like when we cut an apple, it turns brown. Why? Because these polyphenols which are present in apples, they get oxidized in presence of oxygen. Last is keeping quality. Keeping quality is very important, because only then when we know keeping quality, only then we'll come to know about how long the storage period can be and how long we can keep it in fridge or maybe in ambient temperature. Indicators of keeping quality are appearance, color, uniformity, taste, etc. We apply various processing techniques to food, and most important and very common is thermal processing. Under thermal processing, there are various treatments like blanching. Blanching is dipping fruits and vegetables in boiling water for few minutes or exposing it to steam. It is done to stop enzyme activity and killing surface microorganisms, but it also leads to leaching of water-soluble vitamins. Then pasteurization. You have seen milk, pasteurized milk. You may have seen fruit juices also. They are pasteurized at temperatures lower than 100 degrees Celsius so that all the pathogenic microorganisms, that means disease-causing microorganisms, are killed. But it doesn't kill all the microorganisms. But again, this process also leads to oxidation of vitamin C and loss of various other minerals and vitamins. Canning. It is a very drastic heat treatment where all the foods are heated at a very high temperature in closed containers to kill all the microorganisms. Again, it denatures proteins, that means changes the structure of proteins. Rancidity means produces an off odor in fats and oils, degrades sugar and starch, and leads to loss of vitamins. Then ionizing radiations, which is a recent technique of preservation. Here we preserve food by using gamma rays, which are radiations. Now they again bring about various changes, like convert starch into sugar and lead to loss of thymine, vitamin K and niacin, folic acid, thymine also to some extent, but they are retained also. Pigments. We have already seen the pigments which give color to foods. They are also affected by heat and by acid and alkali. For example, leafy vegetables have chlorophyll which becomes olive green on prolonged heating, and it becomes intense green if we add soda to it. That means when we give alkaline conditions. Similarly, beetroot has anthocyanins which are bright red in presence of acid and reddish purple in presence of alkali. Now after processing, coming to storage, what changes take place in foods during storage? Various changes take place. The reasons are metabolism. Metabolism is still there in fruit even after harvest. Then injuries may be there during harvest, packaging material, unhygienic practices of handling like dirty hands, etc. And storage temperature, very high temperature, or aerobic and anaerobic conditions. Aerobic conditions means where oxygen is there, and anaerobic when oxygen is not there in the atmosphere. In both the cases, microorganisms may grow. What kind of spoilage takes place in foods? One is fermentation. Like you may have experienced a fermented odor in apple juice. Then rancid odor in fats and products which are made from fats, like in almonds, they give an odor when they are stored for a very long period. Then bacterial soft rot. For example, in this picture you can see an apple with grey mold rot. Then in another picture you can see a tomato having a blue mold rot. So this kind of spoilage will take place in fruits and vegetables. Then in milk, souring may happen, color may change, in fish odor may come, in eggs also they may lose moisture. Now coming to our topic of food colors. Why do we add colors? Color makes food attractive, and they are naturally present in foods as we have already seen, and they can be added from outside like natural pigments, chlorophyll in saffron, NR2 may be added. NR2 is added in butter which gives yellow color, and artificial colors are coal tar dyes which give very bright color. But then as you can see in this picture, their limit should be limited. Their maximum limit is should not be more than 0.2 gram per kg because they are carcinogenic. That is, they may cause cancer in the long run. Now coming to different types of foods which are available in the market and which we find everywhere. First is health foods. These may be manufactured, like Horlicks, etc., Bonvita, etc. You have seen them in the market. They are manufactured products. They are nutritious and they may prevent disease also and maintain health. Even natural foods like whole grain cereals and yogurt, they may also be called as health foods because they have some specific properties. Then organic foods. These are the foods which are grown organically, that is without the use of any chemical fertilizer and pesticide. These days you are hearing about pesticides so much. Here we can use natural manure, neem, etc. And these days they are becoming very popular. Then traditional foods, for example, sambar powder, sweets, savories, which may or may not be commercialized, and recipes for them are passed from one generation to generation, like grandma's recipes. One of example is khichdi. Now nutritionists are saying that khichdi is very nutritious because it contains all the proteins. But earlier grandmas used to make khichdi without even knowing about its nutrition. Then designer foods. They are also known as nutraceuticals, medical foods, functional foods. They give us special nutrients or prevent certain disease. For example, red wine is now considered to be a health food or nutraceutical because it contains polyphenols which prevent heart diseases. Similarly, garlic. If we eat garlic every day, it is believed researchers have shown that garlic will reduce cholesterol level in our blood. After foods, we come to food packaging. We need packaging because it helps in convenient marketing and distribution. It protects package during transport and prevents microbial and insect damage and also reduces changes. There are various kinds of packaging in the market, like traditional packages are boxes, cartons, cans, bottles, jars. And there are new innovations, new techniques also like aseptic packaging, microwavable containers, modified atmosphere packaging and controlled atmosphere packaging. See, these are the types of packages, a can, carton, a bottle and jars. And these are innovative, like MAP, where apples are packed in a film, then microwavable packs, and these are Tetra packs, as you can see them in markets. Now, fresh produce may have to be packaged as well as processed product. So, for fresh produce, we may use two techniques. One is MAP, modified atmosphere packaging. Here, we replace the air with a mixture of gases, which will reduce the rate of spoilage. For example, you know that normally in the atmosphere, oxygen is 20% about and nitrogen is about 80%. If we change it and make it 2:98, like nitrogen 98% and 2% oxygen, microorganisms will not get enough oxygen for their growth. So this will reduce spoilage, rate of spoilage, and we can store the food for a very, very long period. In pre-packaging, we package the produce in consumer size units at the producing center or at the terminal market. This will reduce damage and moisture loss and also reduce shopping time for the consumer. For processed products, as we have already seen all the packets, we can use metal cans, jars, flexible plastic packaging material, and then we can go for bulk packaging. For example, before making apple jam, we can first make apple pulp and package it in a plastic laminated pouch and then store it for many months maybe, and then whenever it is required, we can use it and make apple jam from it. Then aseptic packaging, here product in containers are sterilized separately and packed in aseptic conditions. In can, we take food, fill it in the cans and then sterilize it. Whereas in aseptic packaging, they are sterilized separately. For example, in Tetra packs and in bag in box, here you can see an aseptic filling machine. Then vacuum packaging, here air is removed after filling in containers and before sealing. So if air is not there, microorganisms will not be able to grow. So this ends our unit 9. We come to next unit, that is loss of food value in fresh produce and processed products. Fruits and vegetables are highly perishable, so post-harvest management of fruits and vegetables is very important. Factors which cause spoilage are physical, like temperature, oxygen, light, duration of storage. Then physiological, like rate of respiration, characteristics of foods, protein, fat, acidity. Like if a food is rich in protein, bacteria will grow in it, whereas in acidic foods, maybe yeast and molds may start growing. And thermal factors, like what changes take place during heating, like denaturation occurs in proteins, rancidity, browning, then loss of vitamins and degradation of starch. Then microbial factors are like bacteria, growth of bacteria, yeast and molds. They may come from various sources like unhygienic practices from packaging material and chemicals, for example, pesticides, chemicals from utensils and again from plastic packaging. What changes take place in fruits? One thing is respiration continues. So there is continuous production of heat and CO2 in water. Then water content decreases. There is greater loss at a higher temperature. Starch converts to sugar in fruits and sugar gradually converts to starch in vegetables. Then breakdown of protopectin, which is the parent compound of pectin, this occurs and it converts to pectin. So because of this, texture of fruit and vegetable becomes soft. You must have seen all these changes at your homes also. So to prevent post-harvest changes or to minimize changes, we have to do proper handling and transport. First step in handling is pre-cooling. where we cool fruits and vegetables with the use of air as in forced air cooling or by using water as in case of hydro cooling. This removes field heat. You can see the picture of a hydro cooler here. Here fruits and vegetables are being cooled by cold water spray. Then come washing, cleaning and trimming to remove soil, dust, insect, etc. Then fruits and vegetables are sorted, graded and sized according to our needs. This can be done mechanically or by hand. Then curing, which is done to reduce water loss from vegetables like carrot, onion, etc. It also heals harvest injuries and reduces loss of water. Here first 3 or 4 layers of onion are dried so that water loss is minimized. Then comes waxing, where we apply a thin layer of paraffin wax, beeswax, which will form a layer around fruit and vegetable and reduce respiration rate and prevent moisture loss. Last are packaging and transport. We have seen packaging already, and in transportation it can be by any means, rail, road, sea or air. Coming to cold storage, what cold storage, by this we mean we are storing food at a very low temperature. This could be of two types, refrigeration and chilling, as we do at our homes, where we store food at 4 to 7 degrees Celsius. When we store food at a very low temperature, like minus 18 to minus 40 degrees Celsius, we call it freezing. In refrigeration or chilling, enzyme activity will be delayed and microbial growth will be delayed, but in freezing it will be stopped completely. So freezing is a drastic treatment as compared to refrigeration and chilling, and freezing cannot be done at homes. Then there are some methods of preservation. We want to preserve food to delay microbial growth and kill microorganisms and to delay enzyme activity. This can be done by using methods which include high temperature, low temperature, packaging, filtration, drying, etc. Let us first take preservation by high temperature. We have already discussed that pasteurization, in this we heat say milk at 72 degrees Celsius for 15 seconds or at 63 degrees Celsius for 30 minutes. So this will kill all the pathogens and stop enzyme activity. But this food has to be stored at low temperature in refrigeration because there are some microorganisms still left which may grow if food is stored at a higher temperature. Then sterilization is done in canned foods. You may have seen canned pineapples, and in milk also, sterilized milk. It kills all the microorganisms and even their spores. Spores can be compared to seeds of plants. Then because of this treatment, shelf life of these products is very high and they can be stored at room temperature also. Aseptic canning, we have already seen this. Then hot pack, like in jams and jellies, we pour hot product into sterilized containers but not under sterilized conditions. Then preservation by low temperature, here again refrigeration and freezing come. Then there are other methods like preservation by chemicals, drying. For example, we use KMS, benzoic acid, in fruits and fruit juices, squashes, etc. Propionates are used to prevent mold growth in bread. Then in oils, we add propyl gallate as antioxidant because in oils rancidity occurs. Then drying, for example, in milk powder, potato chips, here we remove water. So when water is not there in food, microorganisms will not be able to grow because they also need water to grow. This also stops enzyme activity and food can be preserved for a very long period, and this also reduces the transportation costs. In filtration, carbonation and fermentation, like in fermentation, in wine and beer, alcohol is produced which acts as a preservative. Then salt and sugar, for example, in jams, jellies, squashes, here we use sugar to prevent, in pickles, we use salt to prevent microorganisms. Then acid, as in pickles and squashes, this also prevents growth of microorganisms. Oils and spices are used in pickles. You may have seen this. They also prevent microbial growth. And antibiotics are used in products like meat and sometimes in fish and seafood. Then irradiation is a recent method where we use ionizing radiations. Here food is sterilized completely. Microbial population may be reduced, and even this prevents sprouting in potatoes. And you can see this is an international logo of irradiation, which should be there and on irradiated products. And evaporative cooling is one more method of preservation which maintains humidity, and it is good to control respiration, ripening, wilting, etc. This ends our unit 10. We come to next unit, anti-nutritional factors, food contaminants and toxic elements. We have seen so many nutrients and so many substances which are present in food. Now we'll look at harmful substances which are present in food. These are anti-nutritional factors, environmental contaminants and microorganisms and their toxins. Let us first take anti-nutritional factors. For example, protease inhibitors, lethargogens, cyanogens, etc. in plant foods, they are mainly present in potato, sometimes in cabbage and cauliflower, and also in pulses and legumes. Mostly pulses and legumes contains these toxins. Like lethargogens, if we eat pulses which have lethargogens, they will cause paralysis of limbs. and lethargens can be removed by a proper cooking of pulses. Similarly, animal foods also contain various toxins and cause poisonings like ciguatera poisonings, cephalopod poisonings, chondroid poisonings, and they can be prevented by proper cooking of food. Environmental contaminants can come from fungicides, from utensils, from pollutants, packaging material. For example, ethylene oxide forms ethylene chlorohydrin by reacting with chloride. And Minamata disease, this happened in Japan many years ago when people consumed fish which was contaminated with mercury which came from river water. Microbial contamination can come from various sources. You can see here from food handlers, packaging material, from animals and birds, from garbage and sewage, and from water also. This can be prevented by using proper techniques. Microbial contamination can occur in form of bacteria like Clostridium botulinum, in form of molds like Aspergillus, which carry out various changes in foods, and they also cause illness in body. Then yeasts, which produce odors in juices, honey, and viruses like poliovirus, Coxsackie virus, which cause illness in infected persons. Now, about learning about food poisoning is very important when we are talking about microbial contamination. There are three kinds of food poisoning. One is microbial infection. Microbial infection is when we eat a food which has large number of microorganisms. So this will cause diseases like cholera, gastroenteritis, typhoid, and symptoms will be vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal cramps, etc. Then parasitic infection like amoebiasis, roundworms, tapeworms, which enter our body by means of food. Food intoxication is different from a food infection because here we ingest a toxin which is being produced by a microorganism. For example, botulism occurs when we eat a food which is intoxicated with a toxin, neurotoxin, which is produced by Clostridium botulinum, which is a bacteria. We can prevent this food contamination by maintaining our environment clean, keeping storage area clean, litter and garbage should be placed away from food, dustbins should be cleaned regularly, toxic substances should be placed quite away from food, and using only approved cleaning compounds, utensils and supplies. Now coming to deficiencies and their consequences and prevention. One very important deficiency widespread is protein energy malnutrition, which is caused by deficiency of protein and energy. There are two forms, kwashiorkor and marasmus. We can see the pictures of kwashiorkor here. This is a typical symptom where the belly is enlarged because fat is deposited in liver, and limbs are having oedema, that is swelling of limbs occurs in this kwashiorkor child. The child parents may think that the child is healthy, but actually the child is very ill. This is a picture of a marasmic child where the child is very thin, muscle wasting has occurred. You can see even the ribs, and child is looking like a little old man because the skin is wrinkled. PM can be prevented by taking a protein rich diet. Then we come to vitamin A deficiency, which causes night blindness, that is we cannot see properly in night. Then Bytor spot, you can see in this picture a spot is there in the eye. This is caused by vitamin A deficiency. And then keratomalacia, which is the severest form of vitamin A deficiency, which cannot be cured and leads to permanent blindness. But we can cure night blindness and Bytor spot by taking a diet rich in green leafy vegetables, yellow and orange fruits, and vitamin A supplementation. And vitamin D deficiency causes rickets in children, which we can see here in form of bowed legs and also pot belly and enlarged joints. And in adults, it causes osteomalacia, where joint pain occurs, frequent fractures occurs, and soft and distorted bones can be seen. We can prevent it by taking plenty of milk, ragi and green leafy vegetables, which are good sources of calcium, and by taking vitamin D supplementation. Vitamin C deficiency causes scurvy. We can see here the person has swollen gums. This is a proper symptom of vitamin C deficiency, and ultimately this leads to loss of teeth, and it also causes anemia and leads to pale skin. Vitamin B complex includes all vitamins like thiamine, riboflavin, niacin, etc. Thiamine deficiency causes beriberi. Deficiency of riboflavin causes angular stomatitis. You can see angular stomatitis here, where you can see cracks on the corners of the lips and texture of tongue has changed considerably. Similarly, niacin deficiency causes pellagra, as in the case of this boy, sunburnt like appearance around the neck. This is the common symptom of pellagra. This can be prevented by taking whole grain cereals, nuts, legumes, eggs, etc. Mineral deficiency, particularly iron deficiency, causes anemia, where we become pale, our RBCs become paler in color, and iodine deficiency causes goiter, where our thyroid gland enlarges. Other minerals like copper, fluorine, sodium, etc., they may also cause some deficiencies. This can be prevented by taking whole grains, green leafy vegetables. By taking a balanced diet, we can prevent all these diseases. See, this is a typical case of goiter where the gland has enlarged. Then a case of anemia where you can see pallor, there is no pinkish color in the eyes, and this is a comparison of anemic blood with normal blood, where in anemic blood the RBCs are lighter in color. we can improve our nutritional status by eating a good diet and also by employing methods which are which can retain nutrients. For example, we can prevent excessive peeling and trimming. We can handle food carefully before milling of cereals. Milling is conversion of like rice into brown rice into white rice. So before that, we can parboil it. That means soaking in water for some time and then drying it. This will improve nutrient retention. We should not use sodium bicarbonate in cooking because it destroys all the vitamin B complexes. And we can also control moisture content and use proper packaging and storage. Lastly, we come to food and residue analysis. Analysis of food is very important because it tells us what is the nutrient amount. For example, for examining protein content, we use Jeldahl method. Then for fat, we use ether extraction method. For ash contains all the minerals. For this, we use incineration, that is burning food in a muffle furnace and then measuring the amount of ash. For residues like mycotoxins, antibiotics, pesticides, additives, we have to use advanced techniques like spectrophotometry, HPLC, GLC, etc. So this ends our last unit. We can again summarize everything. In unit 8, we learnt role of food, undernutrition and obesity and need for energy, food digestion, about RDA's balanced diet and about nutritional assessment. In unit 9, we learnt about food properties and some special foods. In unit 10, we learnt about post-harvest changes and factors causing spoilage. Whereas in unit 11, we learnt about anti-nutritional factors, about food contaminants, proteins, minerals and vitamin deficiencies, their consequences and corrective measures. So this all sums up what we have learned today.
Thank you, Dr. Para, for comprehending the vast subject very in a short time. This is very, I think we may some of the important things we may share with the learners. Now, can you tell us, explain us what is the nutritional importance of fruits and vegetables?
Fruits and vegetables, they provide us most of the minerals. For example, pomegranate is a very good source of iron. Then vitamin A is present in orange fruits, particularly in mango, papaya. Then dates, chuare and khajur, they are very rich in iron. So we should take them.
Then what is the clinical assessment? Or
here we look for symptoms. Jaise, for example, in anemia, we look for symptoms of pallor, paleness of face, paleness of eyes. Then in case of vitamin A deficiency, we see the eyes of the person. If there is a bitoid spot, we'll say that, okay, this is deficient, this person is deficient. So this is clinical assessment.
Then how much energy we need? What are the three components you mentioned are required for?
These components are BMR, where we are spending energy for doing our internal processes, like in breathing, heartbeat, we have to spend some energy. Then physical activity, if we are working, we have to spend energy. That means we have to take energy also. Then there is dietary thermogenesis. When we are taking food, our body will spend some energy. So we should take a total of all these energies in our diet.
Right. What is nutritional labeling?
When we put a label on a food pack, which tells us what is the amount of protein, amount of all the nutrients in that food pack, that is nutritional labeling.
Now this nutritional labeling is compulsory or it is?
No, it is still not compulsory. It's not compulsory, but may become mandatory after this food law comes, safety law. Bill.
Okay. Then what are the temperature and light sensitive nutrients? Can you tell us some of the
vitamin, particularly vitamin B group, thymine, riboflavin, niacin, these are all temperature sensitive, and vitamin C is very sensitive to light, it gets oxidized. So these are particularly water soluble vitamins.
Then what is the difference between health food and designer foods?
Health foods, there is not much difference actually, but health foods which we normally see, Horlicks, Bonvita, health drinks which we give to our children, then which we give to infants. So this is all health food where we are giving getting some particular protein and carbohydrate. In designer foods, they prevent some disease, like some foods which will prevent heart problems, some foods will prevent diabetes. So these are designer foods.
Now this particularly with modified atmosphere packaging looks very interesting. Can you explain something more about this MAP?
MAP is a recent technique and it is now widely being used for fruits and vegetables. Here we replace the mixture. See, we know air has oxygen. If we remove oxygen and replace, add some other gas to it, obviously microorganisms will not grow into it because they also need oxygen for growth. So in this technology, either we replace it with CO2 or with nitrogen.
What is BMR? Can you tell?
Basal metabolism. BMR is rate of basal metabolism. When we are spending energy in doing all these processes, the rate at which we spend this energy is BMR, basal metabolic rate. And this is measured as kilocalorie per meter square per hour. And this will vary for different persons. Like I'll have a different BMR, you may have a different BMR, and a thin person will be having a higher BMR. So this is kind of vicious cycle. When BMR is high, the person will lose weight.
But it will be rate will be higher for tall person or for short?
Yes, for tall person. For shorter person, the rate will be lower.
What is the difference between foodborne intoxicants and foodborne infections?
Yes, we should learn the difference between these two. This is very important because food infection, when we say food infection or diseases which are caused by food infection, here we eat food which has large number of microorganisms in them. So all those microorganisms will enter our body and cause infection, cause diseases. For example, in cholera this happens, Vibrio cholerae, this goes inside our body. Then in typhoid also, microorganism, this goes inside our body and causes illness after 3 or 4 days maybe, when we have eaten the food. But in case of food intoxication, the microorganism has already produced toxin in the food. So when we'll eat this food, toxin will go inside our body and then cause intoxication. For example, Clostridium botulinum, it is there in canned foods and it causes paralysis. The person may die even in few hours.
What are some other foodborne diseases which can be there? Can you enumerate? Can you tell us?
Diarrhea is there, very common, dysentery, shigella. Then jaundice, this is also foodborne disease. Waterborne diseases may also be included in foodborne diseases.
Now, particularly from for the course point of view, how can we reduce the nutrient losses
At home level, we can employ proper cooking methods. Like we should minimize trimming and peeling. We should not take out thick peels, as in case of cucumber. Try to eat it with peels when we are eating it raw. Then don't cut it too finely. If we are already cooking it, suppose we are making potato vegetable, don't cut it too finely. Just cut big pieces so it will retain most of the nutrients. Then similarly, don't add soda to improve the color. Many people add soda in the vegetable to improve color because it looks very good. But then it destructs all the vitamin B complex. So it will not help us in any way. It will just look good. Similarly, for other things, at industrial scale, we can use proper cold storage as refrigeration, freezing if required. Then we can employ good heat treatment methods. For example, pasteurization. Rather than going for sterilization, we can pasteurize it and store it at low temperature as we do it in milk. So all the vitamin B complex are saved also and microorganisms are also killed.
So friends, we thank Dr. Para, and it is good that we have studied the importance of fruit and vegetables. It is an expensive source and we should utilize them properly. That proper processing at home level, at the post-harvest management and in the development of value-added products, we must ensure that the nutrients are not lost. Like she gave the example, pasteurization may be better than the sterilization. Eating raw fruits and vegetables may be better, and particularly for the women who are working at the field level or at the farm level. Thank you very much.